Okay, good morning. I think we'll start. So last week we started our investigation of the Gaussian free field. So I would like to just remind you where we arrived. So last week. So first, just briefly recall what the Hamiltonian of the model is, because we'll play a very important role today. So it's 1 over 4D. Sum over all edges intersecting the box lambda, phi minus phi j square, plus the mass term, which was m square over 2, sum over all I in lambda, phi I square. And then we wanted to rewrite this Hamiltonian in the canonical form. And so that was the first thing. So what we did is that we considered an arbitrary collection of real numbers, phi I, indexed by the vertices of ZD. So this is just an element of R to the ZD. And we assume that this collection of numbers was frozen to some boundary condition outside the box lambda, a finite box lambda. So we had that phi j equal eta j for all j not in lambda. And then what we proved is the following. So we considered the analog of this first quadratic term here, which was sum over all ij in e lambda b, fi minus fj j square. And we proved that this can be rewritten as minus f minus u scalar product the discrete Laplacian in lambda f minus u, so the restriction to lambda of the discrete Laplacian, a plus boundary term, which we denoted like that, where u was just, again, a collection of real numbers, ui, I and zd, that depended only on the boundary condition eta in the box lambda. Depending only on eta and lambda. And we saw that this identity holds only if we can show that it's possible to find such a collection U that satisfies particular Dirichlet problem. So U has to satisfy what we call the massless Dirichlet problem with boundary condition eta, which was just the fact that u is harmonic in lambda, that is Laplacian u I is equal to zero for all I in lambda, and it's compatible with the boundary condition, that is uj is equal to eta j for all j not in lambda. And that's what we did last week. We're exactly at this stage. So now what remains to be done to conclude this proof is that indeed this system has a solution. And we have to be sure that the U that satisfies that exists. So what we are going to do is we are going to do that in two stages. First thing, I will show that this system has always at most one solution. That's a very classical statement that many of you probably have already seen, but I will redo it. It's very, very short. So uniqueness of the solution, and then we'll construct explicitly a solution a bit later today using a simple random walk on ZD. Okay, so that. Okay, so let's look at the uniqueness problem. So it's lemma 811. So this Dirichlet, massless Dirichlet problem with boundary condition eta possesses at most one solution. So the proof is easy, it's done in two steps. The first step, we consider the particular case where eta is actually equal to zero, so the zero boundary condition everywhere outside the box lambda, and so eta equals zero. Okay. So now we take a solution u to this massless Dirichlet problem with zero boundary condition. And then we select inside lambda one particular vertex, which is one of the vertices where the absolute value of u takes its maximal value. So let I star in lambda be such that u I star in absolute value is equal to the max over all j in lambda of uj. And then, just before I go on, just one comment is that without loss of generality, I can assume that ui star is non-negative. And that's because if u is a solution to this massless Dirichlet problem with zero boundary condition, minus u is also a solution. So if for u I get a negative value here, I just consider the solution minus u instead, and everything is fine. So that's since minus u also solution. Okay. So I will assume that from now on. And then we are going to make use of the fact that u is a solution, so it satisfies, it's harmonic inside lambda. So in particular, we must have that the Laplacian of u at this particular vertex I star must be equal to zero. Okay. But this, if I write it explicitly, it tells you that the sum over all j neighboring the vertex I star of uj minus ui must be equal to zero. However, we have assumed that ui star is the largest value that you can see in the box. So this is a star, I star here. So these, all these differences which appear in this sum are all smaller or equal to zero. Okay. But they have to sum up to zero. So the only possibility is that they are actually all equal to zero. Neighboring I star. But then you can repeat the same argument starting from any of these vertices, which means that uj has to be equal to ui star for all j which are in lambda union the exterior boundary of lambda. But outside lambda, u has to agree with the boundary condition, which is assumed to be zero, which means that uj has to be equal to zero for all j in lambda, which means that u is just the zero solution. Okay, so that's part one. If you have zero boundary condition, there is only one solution, which is the zero solution. So now let's take a general boundary condition eta. Let's take u and v, two solutions to dp zero of eta. Then we consider their difference, u minus v, and this is a solution to dp 0 of 0, which means that by what we have just seen, h has to be equal to 0, which means that u is equal to. Okay, and then we have uniqueness. So the question of uniqueness is really completely elementary. And what is of more interest to us is the question of existence. So that's what I want to discuss next. But for this, I will now focus for a moment on the massless case. So let's consider the massless GFF. Again, just
simplified
square, just this guy. And this guy, I want to use what we have done here. So this is 1/2 phi minus u minus 1/2b Laplacian lambda phi minus u plus boundary term. Okay, just particular case of what we did. This 1/4d comes from the 1/4d which is here. Then the observation that I already made last time, that these boundary terms play no role, comes from the fact that the density of your measure mu eta lambda m is of the form, let's say, let me just e minus 1/2. I rewrite it using this notation, so it's phi minus u minus 1/2d delta lambda phi minus u over the partition function, which is of the same type, e minus 1/2 phi minus u minus 1/2d delta lambda phi minus u. And then I get this boundary term coming out here, but also in the denominator, and they don't depend on omega, on the realization inside the box, only depend on the boundary conditions, so they come out of the integral and they cancel, so they disappear, so this guy is completely irrelevant and does not affect the probability measure. Okay. So now what we, the next step, is the following. So we are not fully happy with an expression the way I have written it here, because this here, from this expression, in principle, I can read u. Once I've shown that what is the solution to this massless Dirichlet problem, I will know what is the mean of my Gaussian field. This will follow from the form of the unique solution to the Dirichlet problem. But from this, I cannot immediately read the covariance matrix, because this should be the inverse of the covariance matrix. The inverse of the covariance matrix of the field. So if I want to be able to read what are the covariances of my Gaussian field, I need to inverse this operator here. So that's what I want to do now. I want to find a nice expression for the inverse of this operator. So that will be, maybe I just, okay, so it's 8-for-1 random walk representation. So we need to invert minus 1/2d Laplacian lambda. Okay. So the basic observation is that I can rewrite this as I lambda minus p lambda, where I lambda is just the identity matrix in lambda, and p lambda is the matrix with entry pij, ij in lambda, where pij are given by 1/2d if I is a neighbor of j and zero otherwise. And these are the transition probabilities of the symmetric simple random walk on ZD. Okay. It's there. let me just introduce a bit of notation that corresponds to this simple random walk on ZD. I will denote by pi, like that, the law of the symmetric simple random walk Xn on ZD, starting at I in ZD, that is pi x0 is equal to I is equal to 1. It starts at I times 0. And I think that's the only notation I need. So now I can state this lemma 812, which is a technical lemma that will be very useful to us. So take a finite subset of the lattice, denote by tau lambda c the infimum over all times at which the random walk leaves the box lambda. It's the first time it exits the box lambda, first exit time. From lambda, then there exists a constant C, which depends on the box lambda, but which is strictly positive, such that the probability starting from any vertex I inside the box that tau lambda C is larger than n, this is exponentially small in n. So in a finite set, a simple random walk does not want to stay very long, so the probability decays exponentially fast. And the proof is completely elementary also. Look at the L1 distance between two vertices J and I, that is the number of steps that the random walk would have to take to go from I to J. Take the minimum of this quantity over all J which are not in lambda, take the maximum of this quantity over all I which are inside lambda. Then you immediately deduce that from any vertex I in lambda, there exists a path of length at most r, that exits lambda. So now, from this, it follows that the probability starting from I that I exit the box lambda in a time which is smaller or equal r. This is bounded below. Well, I know that there is so I'm starting at I, there is a path going from I to the boundary of the box. Say, take a certain path which is fixed. So I have a path, fixed path of length smaller than r that does that. And then I can just force my random walk to go along the path. And if I force it to follow the path, it will exit the box in a time smaller than r, since the path is of length at most r. And the probability of following a particular path is 1 over 2d for each step. You have to take the step in the direction given by the path to the power of the length of the path, so to power r. So this is strictly positive. And it's uniform in I, this estimate that we get. Okay. So then it's over, because now, if you want the probability starting from any I inside lambda that tau lambda c is larger than n, well, you look at what happens during the r first steps. Maybe the random walk has exited the the set in during these first r steps, and then the event is not realized, or it has stayed inside lambda. But then after these first r steps, you try again, you look at the next r steps, if the random walk exists, then the event has not occurred, or maybe it has stayed inside the box, and you iterate this. Each of these stretch of r consecutive steps can lead to an exit of the box with a probability which is at least given by this quantity. So this probability is smaller than the probability that you don't exit in the next r steps, which is 1 minus 1 over 2d to the power r. That's the probability of not exiting the box during the next r steps. And you have to wait to do that n over r time. Okay. So this indeed is exponentially small in n, which is positive. Okay, so we know that the random walk leaves the property that it stays long inside the box decays very fast. Now, using that, it's very easy to invert this matrix, I lambda minus P lambda, because you can just do it as you do using the usual trick. So I want to invert I lambda minus P lambda. Now, if these were not matrices but numbers, it would be 1 minus x. I want to invert 1 minus x, but you know that 1 over 1 minus x is just the limit of the geometric series. So you want to use the usual trick for geometric series. So you want to multiply this by I lambda plus P lambda plus P lambda square plus P lambda to the power n. And if you do that, then okay, distribute the product, and the only thing that remain are the two boundary terms. So we get I lambda minus P lambda n plus 1. Now if I let n go to infinity in this expression, well, this guy will disappear because, okay, I will explain now. So notice that. So I want to show that this guy disappears as n goes to infinity. So I just have to rewrite it in a better way. So P lambda n plus 1, or P lambda n in general, say evaluated at ij. So that's the nth power of the matrix P lambda, element of matrix ij. This I can write, well, it's just a matrix product, so I1, I2, In minus 1, all these guys have to be inside lambda, and then I get P, how did I write it? The transition probability of the random walk, yes, just these Pijs. So it's P, I1, P, I1, I2, P, I n minus 1, j. Okay. But now for this I have probabilistic interpretation, because what I'm summing over is all trajectory of length n that stay inside lambda and that connects I to j. So I really have, so I have my set lambda, I have I and I have j, and I'm summing over all, okay, maybe like that, all trajectory that start at I ends up at j at times n and have never left lambda. I've never left lambda because all the intermediate steps are inside lambda. So that's just the probability starting at I, that the random walk at times n is at j, and the first exit time is larger than n. But this quantity here, this probability, is certainly smaller than the probability starting at I that tau lambda c is larger than n. I just forget about this event, just keep the other one. And we have just proved here that this quantity is exponentially small in n. Okay. So this probability vanishes as n goes to infinity. And moreover, this series here of matrices that you get is convergent. I mean, it's the nth term is exponentially small. okay, decays exponentially fast. So each matrix element of this sum is converging. So what you get is that if I introduce a matrix G lambda, which I define, so G lambda ij, okay, G lambda, it's a matrix, is defined as the sum n greater or equal to zero, p lambda to the power n, exactly what I would get if I took the limit of this expression here. This matrix is well defined. Exists. Okay. And actually, I can get a probabilistic interpretation of it because that's just the sum over n greater or equal to zero. This we have said it's the probability starting. Okay, so then let me put matrix elements so that I know what I'm talking about. So it's pi, probability that the random walk at time n is at j and tau lambda c is larger than n. That's just the identity we proved on the blackboard there. Okay. And then this, I can just interchange the expectation and the sum. So that's the sum n larger or equal to zero. Or let's say from zero to tau lambda c minus one of the indicator that xn is equal to j. Okay. And that's exactly what is called the green function of the simple random walk. So that's the green function of the symmetric simple random walk on ZD. Okay. And from the identity which is up there, we have that this provides you with the inverse that you want. And let's say I lambda minus P lambda G lambda is equal to G lambda I lambda minus P lambda is equal to I lambda. Okay, so that indeed gives you the inverse that you were, the inverse of this matrix, which was just 1 over 2D Laplacian in lambda. So let me summarize this in a statement of a lemma. It's lemma 8.13, so that I can refer to it when I need it. So I lambda minus P lambda is invertible. And its inverse is G lambda, okay, IJ, which is the expected value. Well, just rewrite what we have just done. Okay. The green function of the simple random walk. Now, one thing that is, okay, maybe I'll say it later. Maybe I'll say this later. So, now we have almost all the ingredients. So we have determined the covariance matrix. The only thing that we have not yet done is to show that this massless Dirichlet problem indeed has a solution. And then once we have done that, we'll be done with this massless GFF. So lemma 8.15, yes, should be correct. So as the last is the unique solution to dp0, dp0, I don't remember I wrote it, so, okay. dp0 of eta is u to ui I in zd given by ui is the expected value starting at I of eta x tau lambda c. So it's ugly to write it down, but it's very simple what is going on. So we have lambda I, and then outside lambda we have some boundary condition which is fixed, which is this eta here. We have some fixed boundary condition eta, and then we are running the random walk, simple random walk starting at I. So it's going around. And at some point, for the first time, it exits the box. And then what we do is that we look at the value of the boundary condition at this particular point. That's the point. So that's the time at which the random walk exits the box. So that's the position at which it exits the box. And that's the value of the boundary condition at this position. So this is this eta x tau lambda c. So we want to show that this is the this is indeed the solution. Where is it? Well, there is a unique solution we already know, so it's enough to show that this particular expression is a solution to the Dirichlet problem. Okay. So, sufficient to show that you solve the Dirichlet problem with boundary condition eta. And then this is done in two steps. First, you assume that J does not belong to lambda. Then, or let's say, I called it I, so let me say I does not belong to lambda. Then in this case, that's the okay, let me write like that. So if I start at I, the probability that tau lambda c is equal to zero is equal to one, because I'm already outside the box when I start. So the first exit time is equal to zero, which means that this expression, eta x tau lambda c is equal to the expectation of eta x zero, which is equal to the expectation of eta I, which is just eta I. So it satisfies the boundary condition outside the box. So that's just ui. Maybe I should have. So ui, which was defined like that, is equal to eta I, so it satisfies the boundary condition. And then the second step is I is in lambda, and then you just use the fact that ui, which is the expected value starting at I of eta x tau lambda c. This you can condition on the first step, so it's expected value of eta x tau lambda c given x 1 is equal to j, probability that x1 is equal to j. this probability is 1 over 2D. This, by the Markov property, is just the expected value starting at J, that of eta x tau lambda critical, which is, by definition, just uj. So you get that what you have shown is that ui is equal to 1 over 2d sum over all j neighboring I uj, which is the same as showing that Laplacian u I is equal to 0. Okay, so it's this provides you with all the information you want on this Gaussian field. Which again, I will summarize. Which is theorem 817. Tells you that under this measure mu lambda m lambda, okay, let me say m equals 0 eta, so we assume the massless case, the collection of random variables phi I in lambda is Gaussian, so that's a Gaussian field, a Gaussian random vector, actually it's finite dimensional here, it's Gaussian with mean ui given by this eta x tau lambda c and covariance matrix g lambda ij in lambda given by g lambda ij is the expected value starting at I, sum n equals 0 to tau lambda c minus 1, indicator that xn is equal to j. So this gives you all the information you want on this Gaussian measure. You know, the Gaussian field is entirely characterized by its mean and its covariance matrix, so we have absolutely everything we need. And now we can see what this implies for the behavior of the field. So we can look at consequences. So let me maybe recall a fact that you may or may not know. I don't want to spend much more time on this fact because we are not going to work more with Gaussian field afterwards. But if you want more, it's in appendix B9. It's that, okay, I write it in a bit informal way. So the convergence of Gaussian fields, Gaussian vectors, or collection of infinitely many correlated Gaussian variables, conversion of Gaussian field is equivalent to convergence. So a Gaussian field is entirely characterized by its mean and covariance matrix. It turns out that if you are interested in convergence of a family of Gaussian fields, so in our case it will be a family which is indexed by the size of the box lambda, letting lambda grow and grow and grow, and I'm interested in whether in the thermodynamic limit I get a limiting field, then this, rather unsurprisingly, is also entirely characterized by the fact that the means and the covariance matrices of these fields converge. So it's the same thing as convergence of the mean plus covariance matrix . So that's true in completely generally for Gaussian fields, but in our case, what this tells us is the following, and that's what I want to discuss. So first thing is that, so let's look at the covariance matrix. So in our case, the covariance matrix of the field is, so this, maybe I could have written this also, so it's really, this is really this quantity. It's ij, phi I phi j. So it's the covariance matrix, so it's the covariance between the field at I and the field at j, which is given by this gij. Let me write it explicitly. Here also I could have written explicitly that this is phi I lambda 0 eta, which is ui. Okay, it's the mean. It's, of course it means that, but let's be explicit. So these two quantities. So I'm interested in the covariance between phi I and phi j. It's given by this matrix, which is given here. In particular, one observation that I've not yet made and which is very important, you see that I have an eta here, but there is no trace of eta on this side. So this expression is independent of the boundary condition. That's a very Gaussian specific property, it's pathology of this GFF, that you don't see in the covariance structure of the field, you don't see anymore the boundary condition. The only impact of the boundary condition is in the mean. You see that eta does appear here. Okay, so the effect of the boundary condition is only to change the mean of the field, but does not change the covariances. Okay, so now I'm interested in what happens to these covariance matrices as I let lambda go to ZD. Okay, do they converge? If they converge, then the limiting object that I get will be the covariance matrix of the limiting field. Okay, so let's look at that. So we want the limit as lambda increases to ZD of G lambda IJ. Interested in whether this converges or not. So we have a completely explicit expression for this in terms of the random walk. So that's equal to G lambda IJ is the expected value of the random walk starting at I, sum from all n which go from 0 to, a priori, tau lambda c minus 1. But now, maybe I could do it in two steps. Okay, I don't think it's necessary. So here, I want you to observe that tau lambda c, this random variable, which is the first exit time, it cannot be smaller than the distance between the initial position of the walk and the exterior boundary of lambda. Okay. Because if I want to reach the exterior boundary of lambda, I need to make at least this many steps. So the time which will be required is at least equal to that. Okay. This is true, say pi almost surely. So I'm starting my random walk at I. If I start my random walk at I, then certainly the time I need to exit the box is at least equal to the distance to the boundary. Okay. Now, when lambda is going to ZD, this time will diverge because this distance will diverge. The distance between I and the boundary of lambda will diverge as the set of lambda converges to ZD. So this time will diverge. So I get limit of an expression that depends on this time. And I can use monotone convergence to take the limit inside. So I now get just the sum over all n greater or equal to zero. So this upper bound disappears because this is going to infinity. Okay. So by monotone convergence, I can take the limit. So I have all n from zero to infinity. 1 xn is equal to j. That's the expression you get. So that's monotone convergence. But now, what can you say about this quantity that appears here? What is it? I'm starting my random walk at I, and then I'm letting it run forever. Okay, there is no more lambda, so it's just running forever. And I'm computing the expected number of times that the random walk steps on the vertex j. Now, as You probably know, I hope you know, the random walk. So let me write it like that. So this quantity, which is here, it's equal to plus infinity when d is equal to 1 or 2. That's because the random walk is recurrent. That is that it visits every vertex of the lattice infinitely often. In particular, it will visit vertex j infinitely often, so recurrent random walk. But it's finite when d is at least equal to 2. That's because the random walk is trans. Okay, so there is an immediate consequence to this observation, is that the limiting field cannot exist in dimension 1 or 2 because the limiting covariance matrix is just blowing up to infinity. For example, the variance of the field at a particular vertex, the variance of phi I, the height at a particular point, blows up to infinity in dimension 1 and 2. So there are no infinite volume deep states. When d equal 1 or d equal 2. So the massless GFF does not exist as an infinite volume state in dimension 1 and 2. In dimension 3 and higher, however, it does exist. I mean, at least this quantity is well-defined. We still have to check that the mean are well-defined, but certainly if I take zero boundary condition, we have seen that the solution of the Dirichlet problem with zero boundary condition was the solution zero. So the field with a mean which is equal to zero everywhere exists. So at least there are, in dimension 3 and higher, there are infinite volume deep states. They all have the same covariance structure. That's because this limiting object that I get here is independent of the sequence lambda that I've taken. I always get the same expression, whatever lambda I've chosen. It's also independent of the boundary condition because of this property of the Gaussian field, that the covariances don't fill the boundary condition. So this covariance structure is universal. So it's true for all the infinite volume Gibbs states. They all have the same covariance structure. But after the break, I will explain that you can construct many of these infinite volume Gibbs states, actually uncountably infinitely many, by playing with the mean. So I will just say a few words about that after the break. Okay, so we start in 15 minutes. Okay, I think we can resume. I think everybody is here. So, I want to continue this discussion. So, as we have seen before the break, in dimension 1 and 2, the field does not have, it has infinite variances and covariances, so it's just, the convergence does not take place, so there are no infinite volume limits. But in dimension 3 and more, there are, and I would like to say a bit more about it. So, as I said, you cannot construct various infinite volume Gibbs states by playing with the covariances, because the covariances are the same for all these infinite volume Gibbs states automatically. However, you can play with the mean, and I want to show that you can construct an infinite number of different infinite volume Gibbs states by playing with this boundary condition eta. And the observation is the following. So remember that u, the mean u for the field in a box lambda, was given by the solution to this problem. So we had this for all I in lambda, and we had that uj was equal to eta j for all j not in lambda. It was this Dirichlet problem that we looked at before. Now, what I claim is that if you choose in a clever way the boundary condition, then you can very easily construct an infinite collection of explicit solutions to this problem that do converge in the limit. And the choice is the following. Assume that, maybe I will do it elsewhere, there is not enough room. Assume that this boundary condition eta that you take, you choose it to be a harmonic function on the whole of ZD. Itself, it's harmonic everywhere. So, assume that the boundary condition you use is harmonic on ZD. By what I mean that the Laplacian eta I is equal to zero for all I in ZD. Okay. Then if you take UI is equal to eta I for all I, then the collection U that you get, this U which is just the collection of UI, is a solution to this problem. Right, because it's just eta, so when I have I inside lambda, I have U, Laplacian of U is just Laplacian of eta at I, but Laplacian of eta is equal to zero at all vertices I of the lattice, so it's equal to zero indeed. And outside the box, if I've taken U equal to eta everywhere, in particular, it's equal to eta outside the box. Okay, so eta gives you a solution to the... So this is a solution to the massless Dirichlet problem. But if it's a solution, it's the solution. There is only one. Okay, we have seen that there is only one solution. So you see that if you choose a harmonic function as a boundary condition to your problem, then inside, the unique solution is the harmonic function itself. You have to take the harmonic function everywhere. Okay. So in particular, if now I'm looking at a sequence of, let's say I'm looking at the expected value of phi I in a box lambda with boundary condition eta, massless, okay, with an eta which is like that, okay, with this particular eta, then this is just given by eta I, independently of lambda. Okay. So of course this quantity converges, they are just constant. So you can take the limit lambda to ZD. Well, it's just eta I, as I said, it's a constant eta. It's just a sequence of constant numbers. Okay. So, the existence of the mean is guaranteed for any boundary condition which is given by a harmonic function on ZD. Now, harmonic function of ZD, on ZD, you have a huge number of them. So first, I mean, the simplest one are just the constant. If you take a constant, if lambda equal a constant, obviously the Laplacian of lambda is zero. I mean, the value at every point is the average of the values at its neighbors. Okay, it's constant. But you can also take any tilted plane, if you want, hyperplane in higher dimension, take a plane which is tilted, then it's very easy to check by hand that at any point you have the value taken at a point is the average of the value taken on the neighbor, so it's harmonic. But actually you can very easily construct all possible harmonic functions on ZD, and one way to do that is the following. Let me explain it for, in order to draw pictures, I will do it for Z2, but the analog things work in any dimension. What you can do is you just take two consecutive rows on the lattice. So take two rows on the lattice. Infinite one, okay, it will be enough. And what you do is that on these two rows, you fix the values of eta to whatever real numbers you want. So you choose a real number as you wish for each point on each of these rows. So fix arbitrary values along these two rows. Okay, so you have already an infinite number of choices. You can choose any value you want for any vertex along these two rows. Okay. And then you use the harmonicity condition, the fact that you want to construct a harmonic function. So you just take the neighborhood like that. So this harmonicity condition tells you that the value that you see here must be the average of these four values. Okay, these three values are already determined because you have fixed everything on these two lines. So the only thing that is free is this value, but you can always find choose this value such that this is satisfied. Okay, you get an equation which has a solution, so you can choose this. So these four values automatically define the value here. And then you can take the next neighborhood, this one, and they will define the value here. And you can iterate that. This will construct you the values on all this third row. And then, of course, you can continue in both directions like that. And as soon as you fix the values on these two rows, this constructs you the harmonic extension everywhere on the plane. Okay, so that's one way of to construct all possible harmonic functions on Z2. And you can do exactly the same on any ZD. Right? Fix the two planes, neighboring planes, and then you will be able to invade the whole space. So it's a huge collection of harmonic functions that you have. Okay, it's an enormous collection of harmonic functions. And for each choice of a harmonic function, you construct a new infinite volume Gibbs state because they will be different from each other because they will have different means. Okay, so what you conclude is that in dimension 3 and higher, you have infinitely many infinite volume Gibbs states. Infinite volume Gibbs states. The last comment I would like to make about dimension 3 and higher, so it seems that the field is behaving in a nicer way in dimension 3 and higher than in dimension 1 and 2, at least it exists already something, but actually it's still kind of a pathological field. I mean, it has properties that are unusual, and I just want to point this out. And then we'll move on to the massive field. And the observation is the following. Let's look at the sum over all I in ZD. I'm again dimension 3 and more. I want to be able to talk about the infinite volume field. So, of the covariance for the infinite volume field, one of these infinite volume fields, they all have the same covariance structure, so whatever limiting field you want. And you compute this quantity, the sum over all I in ZD of the covariance between phi 0 and phi I. That's what physicists call the susceptibility. Susceptibility. It's an important quantity. And let's see what this is in this particular case. So that's just the sum over all I in ZD of the expected value started, I've taken zero, starting at zero of the sum n greater or equal to zero indicator xn is equal to I. Okay. Now all the quantities here are positive, so by Tonelli, I can push this inside, so this is equal to the expected value, sum over all n greater or equal to zero, sum over all I in ZD, indicator that xn is equal to I. Now, when I sum over all I, the indicator that xn is equal to I, this will be zero everywhere except for I equal to xn, where it's equal to one, so this sum is equal to one. Okay, so that means that I'm summing over n, a constant one, so this gives me plus infinity always. Okay, this is plus infinity. So you see that the susceptibility is infinite. So you get an infinite susceptibility in this model. Susceptibility. Which is a signature of a critical system. So if you look at the Ising model, the only point, only temperature at which it has an infinite susceptibility is if you look at the critical point, at the critical temperature, h equals 0, beta equal beta c. It's a signature of a critical system. So this massless GFF behaves naturally as a critical system. Critical system in this sense. Okay, that's all I wanted to say about the massless GFF. Or maybe I can make one last comment, that everything I've said here is very qualitative. I'm saying that this is diverging. I'm saying that the variances are diverging if you take dimension one and two, things like that. But everything is expressed in terms of random walk, the simple random walk on ZD. So if you want, you can compute everything explicitly and quantitatively. You are not forced to do just qualitative results. Let me just mention the kind of things you can get by just analyzing the random walk. Yes?
What is the physical importance of susceptibility?
Okay, it's important because it's related to quantity that appear already in thermodynamics, so quantity that you can measure in the lab. Okay, and the susceptibility for many important phase transitions, the susceptibility diverges as you approach the phase transition. So it's an important way of detecting this type of continuous phase transitions.
Okay, but if it's infinite, maybe we are going beyond maybe the phase transition already happened.
Well, okay, for this model it's hard to say because beta plays no role. So beta I've fixed it to one, so it's a bit of a pathological model in many respects. But if you look at the easing model, it's really just at the phase transition. I mean, what you can prove is that the susceptibility, the two-point function, so this in the easing model would just be sigma zero, sigma I, let's say minus sigma zero, sigma I if you are below the critical temperature, say with the plus state, for example. Quantity of this type, covariance between the spin at zero and I. And these quantities, they tend exponentially fast to zero as I goes away to infinity. Okay. So at all temperature except beta C. So really the only point where you have divergence of the susceptibility is at the critical point. Now there are some models in which you have divergence of the susceptibility, or, as I will say now, a slow decay of the covariance. In a whole non-trivial interval of temperatures. This I will mention later in the next chapter. Okay, we will see an example of this kind of thing. But typically what happens usually is that you have just at the point of a continuous phase transition that you have this kind of behavior. Okay, so I wanted just to give a couple of quantitative information. I will not derive them, it's not very difficult, it's just a random walk estimate, but just so that you see the kind of thing that you can extract if you want. So more quantitatively, the kind of thing you can do is the following. So let's take lambda equal bn so that it's easier to, so the box of radius n, square cube of radius n. And then what you can show is that the variance in the box bn, again, with the zero boundary condition, I can put with zero mass, I can put any boundary condition I want. It will not affect the variance, as we have seen. The covariance structure is not affected by the boundary condition. Then what you can show is that the variance, say, of phi zero in the middle of the box, it behaves like n in dimension one, log n in dimension two, and it's a order one in dimension three and higher. So the fact that it's a order one is what we have already discussed. The covariance do not blow up in dimension three and higher because the random walk is transient. But you can quantify how fast it blows up in dimension one and two explicitly, and you get this linear blow up of the variance in dimension one and this logarithmic blow up of the variance in dimension two, as the size of the box grows, taking cubes, for example. So that's one thing, and the other thing, so that's for any dimension, and then in dimension three and more, you can also quantify a bit more precisely the fact that this susceptibility diverges, not by looking at the whole sum, because that does not give you so much information, except that the fact that covariance is not summable, but does not tell you how the covariance actually behave. But you can look at exactly how the covariance behave, and what you can show is that the covariance between phi zero and phi I, it behaves like I to the power 2 minus d. Okay, so it's power law decay, a slow power law decay. Of course, not summable, because okay, we already saw that it cannot be summable. But that's just to show you that you can, if you want, you can get quantitative information. Actually, you can get the constant, you can get correction of higher order, you can do whatever you want, it's random walks. Okay? So the whole point, what makes this GFF so convenient to analyze is that you have this random walk representation of its mean and covariances, and random walk, we know how to make all kind of computation with them. Okay. Good. So now let me explain how things change when you go to the massive model. Now we are going to take into account this mass term in the Hamiltonian. And this will change everything. So, this I've done. Massive case, it's 8.5. Massive GFF. So from now on, I assume M larger than zero. So the Hamiltonian, as we overlaid this in many times, this model is this 1 over 4D, sum over ij in E lambda b, phi m minus phi j square, plus sum over I in lambda, phi square, m square over 2, I forgot, m square over 2, phi I square. And now, of course, I don't want to restart everything from the beginning, so I'm going to use what we already did. And so what we saw in the massless case is that this sum here, just the sum, this we were able to rewrite as minus phi minus u times delta lambda phi minus u plus boundary term. As we have seen, these are completely irrelevant. I will not spend time with them. Then we had some corrections. We had, I can write them as follows. Let me write them like that. So it would be phi I Laplacian u I. And then we had a plus 2 sum over I in lambda, j not in lambda, but neighbors, of phi I uj minus eta j. Okay. So what we did before, let's forget this term for a moment. When this term is not there, what we did before was saying, was to say that, yeah, okay, I'm not very happy with these two lines. I would like them not to be there. So let's assume that let's choose u in such a way that the Laplacian is zero and that inside the box, and that uj is equal to eta j outside the box, which makes both terms disappear, and then we were happy. Okay? We got this canonical form that we wanted. Now I cannot do that immediately because I also have this term that I have to take into account. So, but I want to reuse this structure, not to start again. So let me explain how you have to deal with this guy. It's very straightforward, but I still want to do it. And the procedure will be completely analogous to what we did in the massless case. So this is equal, let's need some chalk. This is equal, I'm continuing. So I want to rewrite this whole term as follows. So this, okay, or maybe I will work with this guy. So all these three lines, I can inject them there and I get something. So let's see what I get. So the first term is easy. It's this minus phi minus u, 1/2 phi minus u. Then we get this minus 1 over 2d Laplacian lambda. Let a bit of space here. Phi minus u. Okay, that's what I get for this term once I inject it here. And now I can insert this guy inside this expression by just putting plus m squared here. So if I do that, what happens? So I get 1/2 phi m squared phi, which gives me exactly this m squared over 2 phi squared, phi I squared. Okay? It comes from this phi m squared phi. I also get some irrelevant term, which is u m squared u, but this only depends on u, which depends only on the boundary condition, so it's a boundary term, so I can completely forget it and put it inside the b lambda, right? It's just irrelevant. But I get a new term. I get something which is of the form phi m squared u. This I didn't have before. So if I do that, I have to compensate for it. So let's see what happens. So we get this correction, which is minus 2, sum over all I in lambda, phi I, Laplacian u I. Then we get plus 2, sum over I in lambda. Sorry, it's not 2, because there is this 1 over 4d. Right, so this becomes 1 over 2d here. And maybe it's convenient to do it like that. Put minus 1 over 2d as we did before. It does not change anything, but it's just for convenience. Okay, we'll get something like that. And then this term, the 2 becomes, again, a 1 over 2d. And I get j in, not in lambda, I neighboring j. Phi I uj minus eta j. Okay. And then, as I said, I have to compensate for the term of the form phi m square u, which I have twice. It's once here and once it's phi m square u, but I have a one half, so it appears in fact only once. So I can add it here. It will be, I have an additional term here, which will be plus m square UI. That's what I get. Okay. And now, what does this mean? Again, I'm not very happy with. So this is not a problem. This has the right form. It's one half, phi minus the mean, phi minus the mean. Inside, I have some symmetric matrix. I've added guys on the diagonal. M squared is changing the diagonal of the matrix. This is really, as a matrix, this is really M squared times the identity in lambda. Okay, so I'm really adding guys on the diagonal. So that's very good. The covariance matrix will be the inverse of this guy, okay, in the end. So that, I'm very happy with this first line, very unhappy with the second and third line. Okay, and then we have these boundary terms. So what I'm going to do is exactly the same as before. I'm going to choose u in such a way that this is equal to 0 for all I in lambda, and this is equal to 0. So I want this, okay, I'm imposing this for all j, not in lambda. So what I get is that indeed I've reached the form I want, this canonical form, provided u is a solution to the massive Dirichlet problem that I'm going to write down now. So u must be a solution to the Dirichlet problem. Now it's massive, again, with some boundary condition eta, which is given by, let me write this, so it's minus 1 over 2d Laplacian plus m square u, let's say, at I is equal to 0 for all I in lambda. And uj is equal to eta j for all j not in lambda. Okay. So it's exactly the same as before. So if you take n equals 0, it's just what you had before. This guy disappears, and you just have that u is harmonic inside the box. Okay. But now it's not, when m is different from 0, what you get instead of the Laplacian is this new operator. Okay. In this case, I'll say that u is m harmonic in lambda. And when m equals 0, it just reduces to the usual condition. And that's just the boundary condition for the Dirichlet problem. Okay, so we are back to something which is completely similar to what we did in the massless case. The only thing that changes is the appearance of this m square. Okay. So first thing is that uniqueness of the solution to this problem is done essentially in the same way as we did in the massless case. I will not do it a second time. I'll leave it to you, you can check. Uniqueness is proved as in the massless case. It's actually slightly simpler, but massless case. Okay, so I will not do it, exercise. And what I'm rather going to do is I'm going to do this random walk representation. How is it generalized to this setting? That's what I want to explain, because this will give us, again, expressions for the mean and the covariance structure of the of this field, this Gaussian field, in terms of, essentially in terms of the simple random walk on ZD. Actually, a killed version of the simple random walk on ZD that I'm going to explain now. Okay, so it's 851, the random walk representation. It will be completely similar again to what we did. So I have to introduce a new Markov chain. It will not be a random walk. It will be almost a random walk, the usual random walk. There is a slight modification. So let me call it Zn instead of Xn. It's not the same as before. So this is a Markov chain on not only ZD as we had before. So Xn was a Markov chain on ZD with some transition property which were the transition property of the simple random walk. Now I'm looking at a Markov chain on ZD plus a new state which I will call star, okay, which I will the role of which I will explain in a few minutes. Okay. So I'm adding a new state. It's not in ZD, it's something new. Okay. With transition probabilities. These transition probabilities given by, I will denote them P, M, I, J, and they are given by the following. So it's a bit more ugly than in the massless case, but it's, as you will see, the interpretation is very simple. So it's 1 over 1 plus M squared times 1 over 2D if I is a neighbor of J and both are in ZD. I and J are in ZD and neighbors. Okay. Or actually this I can write better as IJ is an edge of ZD. Okay. Maybe it's better like that. Then the other possibility is M square with probability M square over 1 plus M square. You make a transition between I in ZD and J which is equal to star. So from any point in ZD with the probability m square over 1 plus m square, you can jump to star. Then if I is equal to star and J is equal to star, the probability of going from star to star is equal to 1. So it's an absorbing state. Once you're in star, you stay in star forever. And everything else is 0. Okay, so that's my transition probabilities. So what is the interpretation of this process? And then I will introduce some notations. But what is the interpretation of this process? This process is what one we call a killed random walk. Okay, it's killed symmetric simple random walk on ZD. Why killed? Well, you have to interpret this new state star as the graveyard. So that's the graveyard. So before taking a step, your random walk, it throws a coin. And with probability m squared over 1 plus m squared, it dies. Okay? And so it goes to the graveyard and then never exits the graveyard. It's dead forever. Okay. If it does not die, which occurs with probability 1 over 1 plus m squared, then it just jumps to one of the neighbors chosen uniformly, okay, just like a usual random walk. And then you start again. Before taking the next jump, it checks whether it dies or not. If it survives, then it takes a step as a usual random walk. And you go on like that. Okay? It's a very simple process. Let me denote the law of this process started at some vertex I in ZD by P. I guess I put the M on top. Let me just check my notations. Yes, so I want P, M, I. This will be the law of Zn started at I in Z. Okay, just a notation. there is another random variable that is important in this setting is the time at which the random walk dies. It will die at some point because it has a positive probability of dying before each step. Observe that if you take m equal to 0, the massless case, you recover the usual random walk. So when m is equal to 0, this is just 1 over 2d, the probability of dying is equal to 0. So if you start from a point in the lattice, you stay on the lattice forever. Okay, it's just the usual random walk. But now we are assuming that m is non-zero, so you have a positive probability of dying before each step. So at some point, you will die. So let me introduce tau star, which is the infimum over all n, let's say greater or equal 0, such that Zn is equal to star. Now call it the time of death. Yeah. Of course, this is just a geometric random variable. Before each step, you have a Bernoulli trial. You are just checking whether you're dying or not, and it's independent from one time to the next, and the probability of success is m squared over 1 plus m squared, success being dying in this case. Okay. So in particular, you have that if I is in ZD, the probability starting at I that tau star is equal, let's say, is larger than n, this will be the probability of not dying at each of the first throw of the coin. You always land on the random walk survive case, so 1 over 1 plus m squared. So the probability of not dying for n step will be 1 plus m squared to the power minus n. Okay, 1 over 1 plus m squared to the power n. Okay, that's the probability of not dying. In particular, as I said before, tau star is finite, almost surely. Almost sure with respect to this. Then another observation that is somehow convenient, we'll not do much with it, but in case you do some exercises on it, I don't know yet what we will do. It's convenient, so it's the probability that Zn is equal to j. So I'm assuming that I'm starting from Zd and I'm ending at Zd, so it's not dead, the random walk at time n. Okay. Now, if you look at the definition of this weight, it's very simple to check that this is equal to the probability that tau star is greater than n times the probability starting at I that the usual random walk is at j. It factorizes like that. So it's essentially trivial from the definition of the states. If you write the probability of a trajectory, you will immediately see that this is true. The trajectory going from I to J in n step. Okay, so that's what you have. And this, as we have computed before, so this I can write explicitly as 1 plus n squared minus n times the probability that xn is equal to J. So this reduces computations for this new Markov chain to computation for the simple symmetric simple random walk on ZD. I just have to weight the probability of a trajectory of length n by a factor 1 plus m squared to the power minus n. Okay. Very good. So now I can state our result for the massive model, and then I will prove it. Let's do that. So it's theorem 826. It tells you the following. So take lambda finite. At least one. Take a boundary condition eta in omega. And now eta is only defined in ZD. Omega is the set of configuration on ZD. But now I have this additional state, this graveyard state. So I need to define eta also in this state so that the values of, okay, as you will see, otherwise some random variable will be ill-defined. So let me just define eta at star equal to zero. Okay, just to extend eta to this graveyard. Then, under the Gibbs measure mu eta lambda m, our spin random variables, phi lambda, phi I lambda. This is a Gaussian random vector, Gaussian as before, with mean that I will denote u lambda m, which is u I m I in lambda, okay, given by something that will be very similar to what we saw before. So u I m is just the expected value starting at I with the under the measure with the killing of eta z tau lambda c. Now here I have to be a bit more precise. It's a bit ambiguous what I've written, because what does it mean tau lambda c? Is it the first time my random walk steps on a vertex which is outside lambda c, or is it the first step it exits lambda c, which is not the same, because you can exit lambda by dying now. Okay. So what I mean is really exiting lambda. It's not entering lambda c, it's exiting lambda. So here tau lambda c is the infimum over all n such that zn does not belong to lambda. So it can exit lambda by dying. That's allowed. And that's exactly why I need to extend eta to the graveyard. I need to know what eta star, what is the value of eta star, because it's possible that I have to evaluate it at eta star. Okay, so that's the mean and covariances, say in covariance matrix. So where am I? Denoted Gn lambda. It's just a matrix Gm lambda ij, ij in lambda, given by Gm lambda of ij. There is a factor 1 over 1 plus m squared. And then it's exactly the same, the analog of what we had before. Expected value starting from I for our killed random walk of the sum from 0 to tau lambda c minus 1, indicator that zn is equal to j. It's completely analogous to what we had before. And in fact, if you take m equal to 0 in this definition, you just recover what we had for the massless case. Okay. It's really a generalization of what we did before. So let me briefly prove this. I will do it quickly because it's the same thing as we did before, but I think it's important to redo it, just to see where this Markov chain actually appears in the computation, because I've introduced it, but I've not motivated why it should be relevant for massless GF, for our massive GFF. So I want to explain that. It's really easy. So let me start with the mean. So I have to check, again, the only thing I have to check is that this definition, this u lambda m, solution to the massive Dirichlet problem with boundary condition eta. Okay, we know, I told you that there is a unique solution, so it's enough to check that it's indeed a solution to this problem. You will check that it's unique if you want. Then let's see. There is a very simple thing, which is exactly the same argument as before. If j, or if I is not in lambda, then again we have that tau lambda c is equal to zero almost surely, and you conclude as before that of course the boundary condition is okay. Okay, it's exactly the same, exactly word for word the same argument as we had before. If I is in lambda, on the other hand, I want to show that why you get this z, this process z appearing. So let's just see what happens. So I need to check whether the proper equation is satisfied. So I'm starting exactly as before. So I'm looking at uim, which is the expected value. By definition, it's this, eta z tau lambda c. Okay. And now we'll do as before. We are going to condition on what happens after one step. So I'm summing over all j neighboring I. And then I will get the expected value starting from j, m eta z tau lambda c, times the probability, I think it was Pm like that, yes, and this transition probability of going from I to j, plus zero. The plus zero is because after one step, what is also possible is that I'm not at a neighbor of I, I might be in the graveyard after one step. But if I'm in the graveyard, eta star is equal to zero, so I just get zero. So it does not change anything to the graveyard. Right? So now, this probability Pmij, which is here, if you look at it here, it's just 1 over 1 plus m squared times 1 over 2d. Okay. Now, multiply both sides by 1 plus m squared, and what you get is that m squared times u I m is equal to 1 over 2d Laplacian of um at I. Okay. So indeed, it satisfies the m harmonicity condition that I wanted. So minus 1 over 2d Laplacian plus m squared times u is 0. Okay. So that's for the first statement about the mean. And let me, to finish, prove the statement about the covariance matrix. It's exactly the same proof as before. So again, it will be pretty quick. And there it will be completely clear why this process appears. Actually, clearer than what you see here, I guess. So, for the second part, we want to invert. Our goal is to invert minus 1 over 2d Laplacian lambda plus m squared, say m squared times the identity matrix, that I'm explicit about these things. Okay. So that's the operator that we had in our canonical form. So I have to invert this guy to get to get the covariance matrix. I have to invert this operator. Now remember that what we did in the massless case was to observe that minus 1 over 2d Laplacian lambda is just the identity matrix minus P lambda, which was the transition probabilities of the simple random walk restricted to lambda. Okay. Pij, ij in lambda. Okay. Good, so now what do I get? I can use this identity. So what I get is, let's say, 1 plus m squared times I lambda minus P lambda. Okay. It's completely empty. But now I can take the 1 plus m squared, I can factor out 1 plus m squared. It will be I lambda minus 1 over 1 plus m squared p lambda, which is exactly p lambda m. So p m lambda. I think it was written like that. Let me check my notation. I think it's correct, like that. I think yes. Okay, so this matrix, this transition probability of the process Z appears naturally in this way. And now you conclude essentially as before. So there are two steps. So as before, the first step is to observe that P M lambda to the power, say, N, IJ, this can be interpreted probabilistically as the probability starting at I that Zn is at j and tau lambda c is larger than n. Okay? Exactly the same computation we did before. You sum over all intermediate steps, you see that it has to survive and stay inside lambda at each stage, and then you get this identity. But now what you can observe is that this is smaller than the probability that just the second part, tau lambda c, is larger than n, okay, that it has not yet exited the box. Okay. And it's even smaller than if I put tau star. It has just not died. Okay. Time n, it sits at the vertex j of the lattice. That means it's not dead yet at time n, which means that I must have an upper bound like that. Okay? And that's good because this tells you that that's 1 plus m squared, 2 to the power minus n. So it's exponentially, since m is strictly positive, this is exponentially decaying uniformly in everything. Okay, lambda, I, j, whatever. It's just exponentially decreasing. So that means that I can conclude the proof exactly as we did before. As we did for the massless case. It's there. So you introduce this matrix GM lambda, which you define now as the sum over all n greater or equal to zero P M lambda to the power n. Just this geometric series as we did before, but now with the matrix with the transition matrix with for the killed random walk, and then this is well defined by this exponential decay that we have just seen. So this is well defined, but this I can write by the probabilistic interpretation of this power as this quantity. So again, let me put ij, I'm forgetting it again, ij, z n is equal to j. Tau lambda c is larger than n, which is exactly the green function we want. It's the expected value starting at I, sum from n from 0 to tau lambda c minus 1, indicator that zn is at j. Okay? So this is a well-defined matrix which satisfies this identity. And now it's clear that if I take this operator, the 1 plus m squared, let me put it, 1 plus m squared I lambda minus P lambda, P m lambda time G lambda, G m lambda. This is equal to G m lambda 1 plus m squared I lambda minus P m lambda. It commutes because G is just composed of powers of Pm, so it commutes with Pm, which also commutes, of course, with the identity matrix, so everything commutes, and it's equal to the identity by the same argument as we did in the massless case, identity in lambda. So indeed, G is the inverse matrix of this operator, this matrix here, and it's given by this expression. So this concludes this generalization of the random walk representation to the massive model. And I had a couple of comments about consequences, but I'll do this next time, take 5 minutes to say what we can deduce from this about the behavior of the massive Gaussian free field. And then we'll move on to, there are many other things that you can say, of course, about this model. There are infinitely many things that you can say. Maybe some we'll ask you to do in exercises, we'll see. For example, it's interesting to see how the field behaves as m is getting very, very small, as it's getting close to zero, because it's at zero we know that there are all kinds of pathologies. We know that the variance blows up, for example, in dimension 1 and 2. We also know that the susceptibility explodes as m is when m is equal to zero. So it's interesting to see how this blow up occurs as m becomes very small. So these are things that you can pretty easily do, and maybe we will create some exercise around that. But what we will do next week is to move on to spin systems, two-dimensional spin systems, in which the spins take value in the n-sphere. And we will see that they behave in a very different way from the Ising model.